Hello, everybody, and welcome to History Bite number 103, dated November 5th, 2020. I'm Walter, your mobile historian and blue-collar scholar. This History Bite is entitled An Overview of the U.S. Supreme Court. Because the U.S. Supreme Court is such a heavy and vast institution with lots of particulars, this will just present an overview of the basics of the Supreme Court so that you can understand how the court functions and its role in our constitutional structure, all right? The court's particulars dived into in a heavy format will be addressed in separate history bites, okay? As it's a lot to the U.S. Supreme Court, and it's not something that can be talked about in 5 minutes, okay? So, the U.S. Supreme Court, of course, is the highest court in the U.S. federal judiciary, and that's the highest court in America, okay? It was established via Article 3, Section 1 of the U.S. Constitution, which reads that the judicial power of the United States shall be vested in one Supreme Court, and in such inferior courts as the Congress may from time to time ordain and establish. So the U.S. Supreme Court is the only federal court established by the U.S. Constitution. All other federal courts, and I mean all other federal courts, were established by acts of Congress under the same article and section of the U.S. Constitution, Article 3, Section 1, okay? The U.S. Supreme Court was officially brought into existence, per se, by an act of Congress, the Judiciary Act of 1789, which established a Supreme Court of 6 justices, 1 chief, and 5 associates. That act also brought into existence the first lower federal judiciary, consisting of district courts and effective circuit courts, all right, which were just the district courts with a Supreme Court justice presiding along with the district court judge, okay? And the court has functioned, you know, as a fully viable part of the U.S. federal government ever since that time, okay? The Constitution of the United States gives the Supreme Court both original and appellate jurisdiction. Thus, original jurisdiction, we remember, means you can originate a case in that court. Appellate jurisdiction means that the case has to have been heard by a lower judicial body or agency first, all right, before coming to that court. So the Constitution spells out the court's original jurisdiction in plain terms, and that jurisdiction cannot be increased by a mere act of Congress, all right, as we learn from the case of Marbury versus Madison. The court's appellate jurisdiction, however, can be regulated stringently by the Congress and has been ever since the beginning, all right? Congress determines the length and scope of the Supreme Court's appellate jurisdiction, okay? The Supreme Court hears about 97% of its cases under its appellate jurisdiction, all right? Mostly coming from U.S. Courts of Appeals, State Supreme Courts, Article I, Supreme Tribunals, and possibly other state intermediate tribunals under certain circumstances if state Supreme Courts will not accept cases under certiorari, writ of certiorari, okay? Only about 3% of the court's cases come from its original jurisdiction, which is very limited, okay? So we're going to get more into jurisdiction in a separate history bite because that's a pretty heavy thing. The Supreme Court of the United States consists of 9 justices, a number that has been the case since 1869, okay? All of its members are Article III federal judges, which means they must be appointed by the President of the United States and confirmed by the U.S. Senate. Upon confirmation by the U.S. Senate, they go on to serve life terms in office until, that is, they decide to retire, resign, or could possibly be impeached and removed, which has only been done once. Justice Samuel Chase in 1805 was impeached, but he was not removed from the Supreme Court. All right. Again, the Supreme Court has 9 members, and in order of seniority, they are as follows. Okay. Chief Justice John Roberts, who has served since 2005. Okay. Justice Clarence Thomas, who has served since 1991. Justice Stephen Breyer, who has served since 1994. Justice Samuel Alito, who has served since 2006. Justice Sonia Sotomayor, who has served since 2009. Justice Elena Kagan, who has served since 2010. Justice Neil Gorsuch, who has served since 2017. Justice Brett Kavanaugh, who has served since 2018. And Justice Amy Barrett, who has served since 2020. Okay? For the record, The number of 9 Supreme Court justices is set by statute, okay? A number which can be changed by the Congress at any time, all right? That number is not set by the Constitution, all right? Some people think that, but that is untrue. Congress can alter the size of the court whenever it wishes to do so. Each member of the U.S. Supreme Court has one of the U.S. Courts of Appeals under its effective supervisory jurisdiction, all right? And under that jurisdiction, the member of the Supreme Court assigned to that circuit has the power to do such things as grant death penalty stays, rule on motions, grant writs, injunctions, things of that nature or extent. Also, they may also sit as circuit justices on those courts if they wish, though no justice has done that in well over a century. All right. Traditionally, the Chief Justice, who is, of course, John Roberts, has the Fourth Circuit assigned to him, and he also oversees the D.C. Circuit as well as the U.S. Court of Appeals for the Federal Circuit as well. All right. So that's just the circuit oversight and the particulars and composition of the court. The court meets in its very, very beautiful Greek temple-style structured building on 1st Street, Northeast Washington, D.C., all right? The building sits very close to the U.S. Capitol building. I've been there many times myself. It's a very majestic and awe-inspiring structure, all right? Very, very modeled after an ancient Greek temple. All right. Just gives you such, I don't know, just, it's just awesome, you know, stepping inside the Supreme Court building and certainly seeing the courtroom. All right. Now, with that in mind, with respect to the cases appealed to the court, all right, on average, about 7,000 to 8,000 cases are appealed to the U.S. Supreme Court every single year. And out of that, maybe, if you're lucky, about 70 to 85 of them will get accepted, okay? So that's less than 2%. So your matter better be good. Your matter better present a significant question of federal law, all right, that is worthy of the court's attention. The court's discretion is virtually entirely discretionary. They decide how many cases they will hear, what they will hear. Most courts don't have such privilege, all right? Even state Supreme Courts typically don't enjoy that privilege, as even they are mandated by law to hear certain cases. All right. The U.S. Supreme Court exercises virtually unlimited, discretion to decide what cases it will hear. With those thousands of cases coming to it every year, at least 4 justices must vote in the affirmative to grant what's known as certiorari or writ to certify. Writ of certiorari to review and certify the matter in dispute, usually a matter of law, of course, in dispute from the case. All right. When the court accepts a case on a writ of certiorari, okay, it will in all likelihood set that case for oral argument. Okay. And while the case is awaiting argument, typically dozens of briefs will be filed on behalf of both the petitioner, you know, the one who has appealed the case to the court, and the respondent, you know, the one who is being appealed against, okay? Litany of briefs will be filed in support of both sides, okay? Once the oral argument process commences, each side will have 30 minutes to present their case, and it is highly unlikely they will get 30 minutes to talk because they will be interrupted by the justices quite often in the process of making their case, all right? To argue before the U.S. Supreme Court, you must be a member of the U.S. Supreme Court bar, all right? That is not optional. To my knowledge, the Supreme Court does not do pro hoc vice representation. You must be a member of the Supreme Court bar. The court sets oral arguments in 2-week sessions, beginning the first Monday in October, lasting until April, all right? Once a case is submitted, all right, the justices deliberate, okay, to decide, you know, who will win. A majority must side with either the petitioner or the respondent, okay, for a case to carry, okay? If the Chief Justice is in the majority, okay, he will assign who writes the opinion of the court. If the Chief Justice is in the minority, the Senior Justice in the majority will assign who writes the opinion, okay? So it's very, very technical on how cases are written, all right? If the Chief Justice happens to change his vote and then will sides with the majority that he originally was not a part of, then he will effectively take over who assigns the opinion, all right? And if he leaves the majority, again, the senior associate in the majority, all right, will make that call, okay? During this time, okay, the opinion of the court, as well as any relevant concurrences or dissents, are also circulated. In some circumstances, a dissent may be so compelling, you know, it may be so powerful, rather, that it may draw others, okay, who were originally in the majority to the side of the dissent, and a whole new majority opinion may have to be written, okay? It does happen, and it has happened in history, okay? But once the opinion of the court is written, at least five members, okay, have agreed to it, at least five, has to be a minimum of five to carry a majority opinion of the court, could be all of them, all right? But at least a minimum of five, okay, have to go along with each and every single word, the majority opinion, for it to carry the day as the majority opinion of the court, all right? Once that's done, all right, the court will release its opinion to the public and the press, all right? The court's opinions are published in the U.S., okay, reports of decisions, all right? And that is why you see those citations at the end of cases, all right? So it would be, let's say, Loving versus Virginia, 388 U.S. 1, okay, 1967, all right? That's the volume of U.S. Reporters of Decisions book that you can find that case, okay? So that's pretty much that, okay? And once that decision is released, if the court has interpreted the U.S. Constitution to render that, to base that decision upon, that decision for all intents and purposes will be final unless it overturns it, all right? If it is a statutory decision, okay, that decision can be effectively overruled by the Congress if they change the language of the statute. But for all intents and purposes, the court's decisions on virtually any type of federal law, including the Constitution, acts of Congress, so forth and so on, will be final. All right. So that's just a brief overview of the Supreme Court of the United States as an institution and some of its particulars. Again, there's a whole lot more that will be covered in individual history bites. So thank you so much for listening to this. Any questions or controversies, please leave them down below and I'll be happy to answer them. Take care. Stay safe out there. And I'll talk to you at the next one. Peace.